metal piece shot out and hit somebody in the leg, I mean, it's, man.
You're talking high pressure.
Yeah, you're talking, I bet that left a mark, that's coming off there.
It wasn't no good for the, I think he might even fractured,
A bone as well?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure, it probably, there's no telling like how much speed wise that thing came off there. But you're talking in some of these cases, some pretty significant pressure, air wise coming out of there.
Cause we had to have, a lot of, PSI, just for them, sandblasters, so, yeah.
I do definitely think pneumatic tools are underappreciated for the hazard as far as like, people don't realize.
Like the trip hazards, when people jerk on them, they go on the, they people with the, you know, and,
I'm so glad that we're getting away from here in shop with these Milwaukee batteries.
Oh, yeah. Those M18 Milwaukee series are.
Don't get me wrong.
A little more expensive, but. Well, yeah, it's just like everything else, I mean, if you're using it properly and using proper guarding and proper technique, it minimizes the potential, but at the same time, if that thing does pop off there, it's coming off hot.
Tripped on the road, which are all kinds of things that, these newer tools are so much better.
Oh, yeah.
The newer tools also have dent set on them, so, you're not having the same issues with air pressure regulations that with them.
They pretty much are making tools a lot more user friendly, so there's just that compressed air, still saying, reduced to less than 30 PSI with effective chip. Because people use that to spray off their clothes. Talked about this already, but big thing when we're refueling, letting the engine cool, but also using appropriate containers for transport. Like I said, we were seeing some interesting things going on there for a while as far as when that supposed gas shortage was going on, filling up everything under the sun, gas, cut off all of it. You really question, like somebody that thinks they can put gas in a Walmart bag, should they be driving a vehicle to get in that? Yeah, they're just putting everything out, just like, this has gotta be. Saw one where they're trying to fill up a laundry basket, you know, of course with holes and stuff, it sounded like, this is disgusting. And that one might have been just for, you know, so they could get clicks on the video or something, but I was just like, this is getting ridiculous.
Doesn't it melt the?
Probably it's corrosive.
It could.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, I know someone said, try to fill up a plastic bottle, it melted.
If it was a thin enough basket, it could. So mentioned with powder actuated tools earlier, gotta be appropriately trained to use this. Guilty's the one that you definitely hear of the most as far as having the, you know, selling those types of tools, but also doing the training. So I said, it's essentially requiring a 22 shell, so I mean, if this is not used correctly, attempting to anchor a plywood form and prep for pouring a concrete wall. I don't understand why he was anchoring a plywood form for powder actuated tool.
That's who they anchored to concrete.
Yeah, but it says he was prepping for pouring concrete.
Why does he make this in the adjacent?
Yeah, that's concrete. True. That's true. You're right. Hopefully that is the case, but otherwise they just unnecessarily fired it. But the bottom line here was, there was someone standing on the other side, and I want to say it's our story correct, but they were like 27, 28 feet away, and it went all the way to the form, and this guy, I'm suspecting, on the other side, got struck right in the head with that, killed him. I mean, just basically kind of wrong place, wrong time feel. And I mean, the odds of that going, of you being directly in line with where that's coming through at that time is so astronomical, but completely avoidable. I mean, I think they've just gone and checked the other side too, made sure they weren't going to work out there before they fire that. Looks like passers. You're seeing there, they fired into a brittle material, brittle piece of wood there. You know, ricochet or all kinds of stuff. I'm honestly surprised that Illinois allows us to use pepper actually in tools. I like to say foil parts. Jacks. Make sure the base is on a firm level surface, centered, placed against a level surface. You gotta be careful with jacks. Make sure we're using jack stands. We're all probably guilty. Manufactured ready capacity must be marked and exceeded. Gotta have that stop indicator on it. Big thing is blocking. Most of us that have changed a tire in here are guilty of sliding up underneath the vehicle probably without a jack stand. Start on one of our, so one of our sections we got to do is, it's called managing safety and health programs. So the intention with the OSHA 30 hour is that, you know, you might find yourself in a role where you could be managing the safety of the job. I'm not saying that you're necessarily going to be a safety person, but you're going to be in a supervisor level position where safety is going to fall under your umbrella responsibility. So that's part of the reason that we go through this. First, we're going to go through this little incident, accident, investigation part, and I'll try to keep an eye on time because I was going to stop to lunch. But, did you, were you involved in the investigation? Did they interview you afterwards?
It wasn't like anything super serious.
You said you were, you, they interviewed you?
Yeah, interviewed you. It was, I was loading coal and a semi truck came on a, an undocumented road. And he didn't relay me a message or anything, had his lights off, and I was backing up, and he parked right behind me. And he was in my blind spot, and I took out his whole, you know, front part of his cab. And so, again, sat there and he should come out and had to do some interviews.
You have a running order? A running order, is that what you have?
And, we both had to get drug tested and he fell, so.
So he got fired, I'm sure.
And come to find out with the fines and everything, a little accident like that cost him $90,000.
Damn.
Jesus.
Yeah, that guy, even though the guy didn't do anything wrong, he just was, just an accident.
Accident, yeah.
And he lost his job over an accident because he failed the drug test. That's what I tell all these, all my students. Doesn't matter if it's legal, if it's not legal.
Yeah.
You know, when you get hit on a job site, they can't tell whether you're high now or you were high last weekend. It's all of it. It's in your system, and if that's part of the job that says that you cannot be, you know, zero tolerance. Zero tolerance.
He didn't know how to use it, so instead of moving it out of the way, he pinned me against the wall. Like, my leg was like all sideways. And I'm like, we gotta back it up. And he pushed it even further into the wall. So I was like stuck in between the wall and the shell sucker.
Oh, that's scary.
That was a great time. But I like swelled up. It took like 3 years, but then finally, like, okay. Because like all the hospital money went on my credit report. And I'm like, this was a work-related incident.
That's terrible.
And nobody interviewed me, like I got some mail from Kroger or
Pepsi.
Pepsi.
Yeah.
And honestly, in places like that, to me, it's just from obviously I have experience working there too. I'm amazed that they do not have more incidents than they do.
Yeah.
Because they allow people that are completely unqualified to operate those straddle stackers.
Yeah. My coworker.
It's terrible.
He lost his thumb because his glove got stuck in one of the other machines. Yeah. So he now he's got no thumb.
Yeah, it's.
It's good time.
But yeah, it's.
So.
What it can all be kind of circle back to lack of training.
Mm-hmm.
They don't train. Computer-based training, basically. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with computer-based training, but when it comes to someone operating a piece of equipment, there has to be some hands-on element. You can't just say, oh, well, this person watched this video and did this little module on the computer. Well, can they proficiently handle the controls on the machine? Because that's what's important, because if they can't, something like that can happen, because they don't know what to do with it. Or they could drop a load on top of somebody. So, I'm just curious, you know, is why I asked that. So, this is just defining safety. What is safety? Isn't safety just common sense? Because we always hear that term. Well, safety is common sense. You know, my argument nowadays is, well, common sense isn't common, so we can think about it that way, right? You know, we're having to put warning labels not to eat a lard and turkey pots. So here's some Darwin Award winners for you. I don't think this will play. We'll see. Sorry. So the top one was actually the funnier one, but I'll explain what happened at the top. That file got corrupted, but I'll show you this bottom one. This kind of people we deal with out there. So the top one here that I couldn't get to play, this guy in the top video was actually decided he was gonna drop his doors and make a Xerox copy of his behind on the company copy. And needless to say, he exceeded the weight limit of that plate on there. That glass plate broke on him, and he went, it's corrupted in the plate for some reason. Yeah, it broke on him and sunk in there. So I'm like, can you imagine, like, explain that, why you're like bare bottom and you're stuck in the copy machine?
I was told ultra loud light kills COVID on your.
Yeah.
He was doing his job.
He was doing his job. What do you mean? I was copying his butt. Yeah.
He was on company time. He must have been doing his job.
Likely excuse. But anyway, so just some Darwin Award winners there for you. So yeah, what is safety? The control of recognized hazards to attain an acceptable level of risk. And that's what it's about. We're trying to attain an acceptable level of risk because there's always a human element, right? Nothing is ever 100% where nothing could possibly happen. We've got that human element, but if we put controls in place and we try to make the work environment as safe as possible, we can eliminate a lot of stuff. We got physical, biological, chemical, and ergonomic hazards out there. This is where we're breaking it down. You know, consistently enforcing safety rules is another way in which we can control stuff.
Since it was so hot and nobody was
asking,
I decided not to wear the hood. I had all the standard excuses. It was hot and uncomfortable, but I think the real reason was my attitude. A fairly new procedure, and I just didn't understand why I had to wear it, and I resented being made to do so.
So he had basically an arc blast occurred there. He was supposed to be wearing a hood because the type of work he was doing. Flashback, and obviously you saw what resulted. He's actually pretty lucky. You see some of those, and it's unrecognizable. Yeah. So some basic assumptions here from people, or really excuses we hear. I'm less at risk than others. We've always done it this way. The one you hear the most, well, we've always done it this way. Well, that doesn't mean you've been doing it right. You know, you can do things wrong a long time. I mean, when I hear that, my first thought is, well, I know people that are out there on the roadway that have been driving for 40 or 50 years. That doesn't mean they're a good driver, you know? It's just that they've been doing it that long.
Drunk and driving for 30 years.
Yeah, exactly. So what, no one was hurt. You know, that's a big one. When people aren't taking the time to look at their near misses. You know, because near misses are a good opportunity to look at what was being done and what actually caused the near miss to happen so that they can prevent it in the future. It's really the only difference between a near miss and a direct hit is a little bit of luck. One of the companies I deal with, they started really using QR codes a lot, and they had QR codes all over the place. And they got what they call a good catch program. So if somebody on site sees something sees a hazard and is able to point it out, stop things before it turns into something, they scan that QR code, fill out a little report, and turn it in. And they get a lot of response out of that because they'll do drawings and watch his cars and stuff like that. So it's a morale booster and it gets them a lot of information. People know their jobs. Well, this is true, but we get complacent. the same job day in and day out,